Penguin Random House Audio presents Learning by Heart, an Unconventional Education. This is the author, Tony Wagner. Introduction. What does it mean to learn something by heart? For most people, the phrase connotes committing something to memory, like a passage from a book, a poem, lines from a play, or perhaps an equation. But what about the phrase getting to the heart of the matter? It suggests something very different, doesn't it? Something you can't arrive at by rote. This is the story of a boy, and later a young man, who rebelled against memorizing most of the things he was required to learn in school. Indeed, he refused to take to heart many of the things most adults told him. The lessons he was assigned and the world he was handed made little sense to him. And so he was driven to try to get to the heart of things, to explore what was truly important about a book, a moment in nature, a concept, an experience of another person, a time in history. He wanted to understand what was really vital, after all, in order to make a meaning for his life and to work with passion and purpose. It is my story, and the questions of what's most important to learn and how things are best learned continue to haunt and inspire me. Chapter 1, The Dropout. When I talk to people who have pleasant memories of their school years, they rarely mention the classes they took. Those who remember school fondly are far more likely to recall it as a time in their life when they had fun with friends, or they excelled at a sport, or joined in an extracurricular activity that excited them. Almost invariably, they say classes were easy for them, and so they got along with their teachers and brought home good grades that pleased their parents. For many students, those for whom school is hard for whatever reason, or who are not popular or good athletes, school is tedious at best, torturous at worst. I was such a student. School for me was a giant jigsaw puzzle with many hundreds of tiny pieces, a puzzle that came with no picture to guide me or tell me how it was all supposed to turn out. I was lost. From first through sixth grade, I went to a small coeducational private day school, half an hour's drive from where my family lived. I have only hazy memories of my classes and teachers there, things scrawled on the blackboard that we were told were important for us to know, heavy, dull textbooks that had to be lugged to and from school every day. What I remember most vividly was being an outlier. Most of the other kids were from the suburbs, and they saw each other frequently after school and on weekends, but not me. We lived too far away. And so during recess, I wasn't invited to join in their play. I mostly just watched from the sidelines. I was also slow to learn to read. Some kids naturally learn much later than others, and then, all too often, parent anxiety and teacher pressure fester and turn a late reader into an insecure learner. For several years, my mother dragged me to a tutor once a week. Mrs. Gray was patient and warm, unlike my teachers at school, and by fourth grade I was proficient. But the beginner reading books, organized by level of difficulty, and the assigned textbooks bored me, and I took no pleasure in reading them. I liked the smell of the blue Ditto sheets fresh off the mimeograph machine that were sent home with us every night, but I hated doing the same math problems over and over. They were even worse than the reading assignments. I didn't do the homework most of the time. About a year or so after I'd really gotten the knack of reading, I fell in love with it just for the pleasure. At first, it was a series of books called We Were There. Each book was a fictional retelling of a real historical event featuring one or more kids as the main characters. I don't remember where I got the first one, but it took me a while to get into it. By the age of 11 or so, I was reading most every night. For myself, not for school. I trekked the Oregon Trail, fought at the Battle of Gettysburg, dumped tea at the Boston Tea Party, nearly froze to death with Admiral Byrd at the South Pole. But it was the books about World War II that most captivated me. I'd watched horrified and helpless as the Japanese Zeros screamed out of the sky and bombed our fleet at Pearl Harbor. I ate bugs to survive in the jungle during the Battle of Bataan. I charged ferociously at the German pillboxes above the beaches of Normandy. I went on to read about the different ground campaigns of the war. The German general, Erwin Rommel, known as the Desert Fox, fascinated me by the way he kept sneaking around the desert, attacking the British, then slipping away. I got interested in battles between big ships. I begged my parents to let me watch Victory at Sea, a TV documentary that each week depicted a different naval engagement of the war using original film footage. The program always closed with the first verse of the Navy hymn, "Eternal Father, strong to save, whose arm hath bound the restless wave, who biddest the mighty ocean deep its own appointed limits keep. Oh, hear us when we cry to thee for those in peril on the sea." The music gave me shivers and made me feel sad. All I felt when they sang the hymns at our little Episcopal church each Sunday was impatience for the service to be over. I tried to imagine what it must have been like to be on a destroyer manning a gun under fire from a Japanese battleship, terrified that a kamikaze would fly into us. I knew what I would have done if I'd been in the war. I'd have been a fighter pilot like my dad. In We Were There at the Battle of Britain, I flew a Spitfire and blew the German Messerschmitt Bf 109s and the Focke-Wulf Fw 190s out of the sky as we battled for air supremacy to save Britain from invasion. After finishing the story, I sought out others about aerial combat during World War II. I learned the names, armament, and performance characteristics of every fighter plane that fought in the war. I wondered which was best, the American P-51 Mustang or the British Spitfire. The P-51 was faster and had more guns, but the Spitfire was much more maneuverable, like a sports car. On my father's bureau, I'd seen a small silver-framed photograph of him wearing his officer's uniform and standing next to the nose of his Spitfire. There was so much I wanted to ask him, not just about his plane, but what it had really been like to be in the war. Like so many World War II vets, though, he rarely talked about his experiences. I did get some answers many years later when, at the age of 70, Dad sat down to write a short account of his war experiences. "For his children and grandchildren," he said. The outbreak of the war in Europe in 1939 found my father selling insurance, taking a few courses at Johns Hopkins University, and playing golf. "My school and college record was spotty at best," he wrote. "My life was golf and good times." His other passion was flying. While he had only 3 hours' experience in a friend's small private plane and had never soloed, he wanted to join the Army Air Corps, but he didn't have the required college degree, and there was a year's wait. At a Labor Day party in 1941, my father met a former Royal Air Force pilot and asked for help. Turned out that the RAF was desperate for pilots, having lost so many in the Battle of Britain the previous year. And so in November 1941, at the age of 21, my father found himself as the only American cadet in a British flying training school. Of the 60 pilots in his cohort who graduated and received their wings, only half survived the war. My father graduated at the top of his class, although he cheated on his Morse code exam, he confessed. Because all plane communications were by radio then, he never saw the point of learning it. After serving as a flight instructor for several months, and surviving a mid-air collision that required him to bail out over the Bristol Channel, Dad was offered his choice of assignments. He asked to be posted to the 41st Squadron because they were flying one of the hottest fighter planes of the war, the legendary Spitfire Mark 12. For the next several years, he flew numerous offensive and defensive sorties, scrambling to chase after German fighter planes, escorting bombers on runs over France, strafing ships and locomotives, getting shot up by anti-aircraft guns, and limping back to base. His pilot's log reads like a script for a classic World War II movie. Cover for bombers at Abbeville, Hugh Perry hit. Rear
cover for. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.